Okay, so the next talk will be by Evelyn Colon de Mello. Evelyn is from Brazil. She has a bachelor degree in chemistry from the Federal University of Espírito Santo in Brazil. Where among other research projects, he participated in a 2 years project investigating the application of industrial sludge in agriculture. And she will talk about extraction of pharmaceutical components from plant materials, method development using accelerated solvent extractor 350. Evelyn, please.
About the title and my name, and my research exercise was under the guidance of Professor Benny Heffetz. Pharmaceutical compounds are products that are used to cure or to prevent symptoms of diseases. And this graph shows us the trend of pharmaceutical production during these years. By the five top pharmaceutical producers. And in developing countries, the trend is much steeper. When we take a pharmaceutical compound, it is metabolized in our body. Some part of it suffers oxidative reduction and hydrolysis in our body, and they become more polar, and these are called phase one metabolites. They also may undergo conjugation, and they are more water soluble and less toxic, and these are called the phase two metabolites. And the part of it may also not suffer any chemical modification. But all of these, they are excreted by our body. For example, for the anti-epileptic drug, the carbamazepine, about 72% of it is excreted in the urine. And here we can see like all the metabolites produced, about 1% is left unchanged, chemically unchanged. And all of these are the metabolites. Some of them are still biologically active. So from the sewage in some places may go to sewage treatment stations. And this is a graph of a research in Germany that shows that, for example, for the drug propranolol, 96% of the pharmaceuticals was degraded. So only of these come out in the sewage treatment station. But for example, for the carbamazepine, only 7% is removed. And all of this is released to the environment. So when a specific pharmaceutical is released in the environment, depending on all of its physicochemical and chemical properties, and also depending on the specific environment characteristic, the combination of all of these factors will determine the route and the fate of this pharmaceutical. In this study, the researcher shows specific different routes for pharmaceuticals in the environment. But our research group focuses more in this route that shows the human medical compounds that goes to sewage treatment and are applied in the field with the reclaimed wastewater. What's interesting about this scheme is that all of these routes may potentially lead to plant uptake if the pharmaceutical is not degraded before. And why our research group focuses that route is because, for instance, in Israel, there is an increasing trend of using reclaimed wastewater for agricultural purposes. And it's estimated that by the year of 2004 and 2050, 100% of this water will be only from reclaimed wastewater. And it's not only in Israel, it's also a world trend. Places of semi-arid and arid climates, and also And also regions that are undergoing desertification may be needing to use reclaimed wastewater for agricultural purposes. So when you irrigate with water that contains pharmaceuticals, this pharmaceutical in the soil may undergo photodecomposition, may be leached to the underground water, may be broken down by chemical and microbes, or may be adsorbed or absorbed to the soil particles. Depends on their physicochemical properties, of the specific pharmaceutical physicochemical property. And when this pharmaceutical is present in the soil solution, it may be directly or indirectly uptaken by the plant when the plant is meeting its evapotranspiration and photosynthetic requirements. The main uptake mechanism is by bulk flow in the xylem through the roots, driven by the decreasing water potential from the soil solution to the atmosphere. And also, the plant characteristic is another variable here that will determine the uptake of the pharmaceutical extent. Depends on the root morphology and also on the lipid content of the leaves. So the effects of long-term human exposure by this pharmaceutical crop through the plants that we eat is still unknown. It's a relatively new issue, and it needs to be investigated. And because of that, it is important to be able to quantify exactly the amount of pharmaceutical in plant tissue. So then we can deal with issues of environmental toxicology, the impact of these pharmaceuticals in plant development, the development of super microbes in the soil that may be exposed to these to antibiotics, for example, and of course to deal with issues of food safety. So the objective of my work was to develop an extraction methodology using accelerated Sonwell extractor Dionex 350 to quantify pharmaceutical compounds in plant tissue. And the reason why we needed to develop a methodology is because the accelerated solvent extractor is not commonly used by all researchers. A few of them use it, and the protocol varies. So we wanted to develop a method to use in our samples, and of course with good recovery, so it's a reliable method. And what are the advantages of the accelerated solvent extractor compared to another extraction techniques? It is an automated procedure, so it's very easy to do. It's basically a one-step extraction. We can attain fast extraction because we use high temperatures, up to 200 Celsius, and high pressures, so we keep the solvent in liquid state. And we can choose the solvent we would like to use or mixtures of solvent. And the procedure, this is the ASC, the accelerated solvent extractor. And the procedure, we load our sample here in these vessels, and we select the method in this display. The cells go back here to the oven where it's heated, and it reaches temperature equilibrium, and the extraction takes place. And then we collect the extract in those glass vials where we after do the chemical analysis. So in my experiment, we use Chinese cabbage and red bell pepper fruits as a sample. We put it in the lyophilizer so it gets dried, freeze-dried. Then we put the sample in the ball mill, so we get a very thin powder of the plant material. And then with that powder, we prepare the cell by putting a glass fiber filter in the bottom. We put approximately 1 gram of plant material. We spike a known amount of pharmaceutical on the plant material. We add 2 layers, 1 gram each, of a dispersing agent. And the dispersing agent is an inert material that by using it, we are helping, we hope that it will help clean a bit of the plant matrix. Also, we use less solvent for that. And then we load the cell in the ASC. And this was the parameters we chose for our extraction. So the overall experiment was divided in two stages. The first stage was consisted actually in the method development, and for that we use higher concentrations of pharmaceuticals because it's easier to work with higher amounts. This is in PP parts per million levels. And the quantification, we did it by the high-performance liquid chromatography. And this is the apparatus, and this is how the results come out. And this, after we developed the method, we did the second stage, which is to use environmental relevant pharmaceutical compounds concentrations. So it's the concentrations that is the pharmaceuticals is present in natural samples in the environment. And to be able to measure that, we needed to use the LC-MS, which is a liquid chromatography called by to a mass spectrometer. And this is the apparatus, and that's how the results come. So for the method development, we did three tests. The first test was to choose which solvent we're going to use. So we did. So we used three different ones. We only use one sample type because we were just developing the method first, and we use a stock solution. There was a mixture of three pharmaceuticals, carbamazepine, which is an anticonvulsant, diclofenac, anti-inflammatory, antipyretic, gemfibrozil, that regulates lipid, ketoprofen, sulfamethoxazole, and sulfapyridine, which are both antibacterial. And these are the results of our first test. We can see that consistently for all the pharmaceuticals, the methanol solvent provided significantly higher recovery values. And just to explain what recovery is when we know the amount we added of the pharmaceutical in the beginning, and the amount that we can quantify in the end, the ratio between them, that's the recovery, and here it's recovery percentages. For the gemfibrozil, the amount we added was below the limit of quantification, so that's why we have no value here. And the sulfapyridine peak was in between the peak of, in between two peaks that we believe that are another chemicals that were extracted together, so they interfere in our measurements. So it was not possible to quantify it using this method. So we decided from this stage that we're going to keep methanol as our solvent. So for the second test, which was a test that we did so we can understand better the system, we didn't use any pharmaceutical. We analyzed an empty vial and a vial with only the dispersing agent, and also a vial only with the cabbage sample and a vial with the cabbage and the dispersing agent. And the results was that our cells weren't contaminated. The dispersant agent didn't provide any readings, so it's also not contaminated. And for three pharmaceuticals, the diclofenac, gemfibrozil, and naproxen, we didn't have any reading in the chromatogram in that region. But for the three others, we had a reading. I'm just going to show you the chromatogram so you can understand that when a sample has the six pharmaceuticals, we're going to have the six peaks that indicate that we have them in our sample. This is the absorbance, and this is the retention time in the chromatogram column. And for when we just investigated the sample without the spiking pharmaceutical, we got three peaks in the region for these three pharmaceuticals, which indicates that we're extracting other chemicals that also come out in this time, in this same retention time. But when we compare the results from the plant material alone and the plant material, the dispersing agent, we see that the dispersing agent partially cleaned our matrix. So we see that we got significantly lower results. And so we can conclude that the dispersing agent is helping our analysis because it's partially cleaning the sample matrix. And we're going to continue using this dispersing agent. And the last test for the first stage was to determine the optimal static cycle for our analysis. So we repeated this time with another stock solution that had carbamazepine, gemfibrozil, and also two other pharmaceuticals, ibuprofen and naproxen. They are both anti-inflammatory, and we vary the number of static cycles from 1 to 3 to see the static cycle number effect. And in our results, we see that for most pharmaceuticals, there wasn't any significant difference. So the static cycle number did not affect our analysis. Probably with one, it would be enough to extract the pharmaceuticals, but we decided to keep two static cycles, so we make sure that we allow enough time for the extraction in our procedure. So this was the conclusions for our extraction protocol developed. Methanol, two static cycles, we used a dispersing agent, and we got satisfactory absolute recoveries for our analysis. So then that we have a method, we also analyze our pepper samples that is piped with the same procedure, and this was the absolute recoveries that we obtained, which were also satisfactory. So now we move on to the second stage, which is to use the same extraction protocol, but now we're going to spike with 100 times lower concentrations in parts per billion levels. And we use a stock solution of 16 pharmaceuticals. And because the concentration is so small, any kind of loss would really interfere in our final results. So we did an internal standard addition using labeled compounds. So then we can correlate the two signals, and then we can correct for any type of loss during the procedure. And besides all the and this new stock solution had all the pharmaceuticals I already talked about, plus benzafibrate, which controls lipids, and caffeine, stimulant, clofibric acid that is also control lipids, d-n-butylphthalate, which is a plasticizer, and it's released by plastic, so it's present all over in the environment, erythromycin, and triclosan that are bacteriostatic, metoprolol that controls high blood pressure, and sildenafil, which is Viagra. And we spiked the pharmaceuticals in three different patterns. One, we spiked both the stock and the label compounds before the ASC stage, and then with the extract, we loaded it in the LC-MS. The second pattern was to spike only the labeled compound directly onto the extract and load it in the LC-MS, and that's our blank. And to spike both the stock and the label after the extraction. And so then we can actually compare what is lost in this ASC step when comparing the spiking pattern 1 and 3. And with the signals we obtain from all the analysis, we calculate our absolute and our relative recovery. The absolute recovery is the ratio between the signal we get before extraction and after extraction. And we have both formulas here because one is for the stock and one is for the labeled compound. And should be the same because although they are the same molecules, so they behave the same. So their absolute recovery theoretically should be the same. And the relative recovery, which is the ratio of the ratio of the signals before extraction and after extraction. So here is our results with the cabbage leaves. Here we see that for some of the recoveries, we get better values after the internal standard addition correction. For some of the compounds in our list, we couldn't quantify because it was higher than what we added. For another one, we believe that it degraded before the quantification. And for another, maybe just because the method didn't work for this specific compound, and this is the continuation of the results obtained. So the conclusions for the second stage of my experiments was that for some of the pharmaceuticals, there was no loss to the extraction procedure. When we did the investigation with the pepper sample, because the pepper powder is much more hygroscopic, So we believe that we had a different contribution from the plant matrix in the quantification. So we had a wide variation in the results, so it wasn't possible to quantify. But we believe that for the next time when we repeat, we need to dry the sample right before we weigh it. And that may solve the problem. And we need extreme precision in the spiking stage for this analysis, because we spike 10 microliters and it's an analytical. And so any variation in the spiking for all the replicates cause a big difference in the final result. And my overall conclusion is that for most pharmaceuticals that we analyzed, we got satisfactory recoveries. The LC-MS analysis for some pharmaceuticals offered low recoveries for some of the spike pharmaceuticals, but after the internal standard addition correction, we got 91 to 117% recoveries, which indicate that our method was efficient and we can use that for future investigations. And the plant tissue, which provides complex sample matrices, pose an extra difficulty for pharmaceutical quantification. So we may need to modify a bit the method when we are gonna do the analysis for other crops. And future work would be to analyze commercialized samples that were irrigated with reclaimed wastewater, so I can quantify the pharmaceuticals present in those and estimate the average intake by the population of PC through the food. And I would like to thank Professor Benny Heifetz and everyone from our research group, especially Ron. And I want to thank my classmates and all the professors for the intellectual support and the friendship, and the Pierce Foundation for giving us the opportunity to be here in Israel doing our research.
Thank you very much. After your last slide, no one will eat corn anymore. Yes.
Thank you, Evelyn. Just look, these pharmaceuticals are, most of them, they are plant origin, right? Pharmaceutical things that are derived from plant. I mean, we use plants to produce most of the pharmaceuticals.
No, I mean, a lot of the pharmaceuticals are developed from chemicals that are extracted, discovered in plants, but then there are a lot of synthetic pharmaceuticals which are not necessarily plant derived.
Okay. To my knowledge, most of them are plant origin or derivatives of plants. At the same time, we are also using heavy chemical synthetic insecticides and pesticides to agriculture, right? I mean, why there is a raised concern about this one, mm-hmm. despite the fact that there are also another a lot of things.
Uh-huh. Because pharmaceuticals, they are designed, they are produced to treat, to be biologically active and to treat humans and animals. So they have, when we uptake it, there is an effect in our body. So these specific chemicals, so we don't want to take them if we don't need to take them. And that's, I also said that it's also trace levels that they are present in plants. It's not like you're taking a whole pill, but some people may be allergic or maybe in trace levels at long term exposure may cause something that we don't know yet because it's recent. It's a recent issue, but these are chemicals that are biologically active and that interfere with our metabolism. We can see like the carbamazepine, which is, it works with our brain function. We don't want, nobody wants to take them.
take them, it will remain at us being biologically active in plants once they are taken up by planters?
they may they still be biologically active, and I show that scheme of the metabolites. Sometimes they can go back to the original compound, or they can interconvert, because it all depends about the physiochemical properties of the environment and of the, and everything can happen. I mean, if we don't, if we're not aware of it.
I didn't understand. The single was based, the rate of recovering was based in the signal before extraction and after extraction, right?
Mm-hmm.
So why do we have rates of recovering higher than 100%?
This is theoretically it shouldn't happen, but when I said that plant matrices are complex matrix because they have a big chemical affinity with the pharmaceuticals. They're all hydrophobic. And so sometimes in the extraction, you extract other compounds that may interfere with analysis, like we saw in that graph that I showed, that without adding PCs, we got peaks in the chromatogram. So we have interference, and that's why we need to develop a method that would allow us quantification, and not always that will, can happen. But in the literature, you see that, especially when PPBs level, the recoveries may vary from 140% to 60%. As long as you can repeat it, that is reproducible, so it can be reliable. And that's why we do the internal standard correction. So then we can do the ratios instead of finding absolute values.
But then in the conclusion, it still says after doing all the processes that we're still getting 70% more than 100%. I think it says 117%.
Yeah, but this is experimental values. Mm-hmm. That's why it's 117. It's not theoretical.
Okay. Okay.
Still, Evelyn, what I'm concerned is to what extent do these standard samples that you prepare by adding a certain amount of pharmaceuticals, to what extent they represent the values that you will get from field-grown plants in which the pharmaceuticals were absorbed and maybe binded to different parts of the cell matrix, etc.
Yeah, definitely is different, and there are people in our research group that investigate the uptake by the plants of the with water that is irrigated. But my work was just to develop the method to quantify, so that's why I spiked, because I needed to know the exact amount, not what may be available if it was under real situation, because I was just developing the method to quantify. But of course, to spike is not the same as to be uptaken by the plant, because also, as I said, it can be photodegraded, it can be degraded by microbes. So did I answer your question?
No, not yet. I mean, let's say that in the plant material there is a certain amount. Do you expect the same recovery rate from plant material that absorbed this pharmaceutical throughout its life cycle as compared to your samples that you applied it externally?
I see. Maybe not, but if the extraction procedure is good, if the extraction methodology is good, so it has to extract all the pharmaceuticals. But
Do you think this method could also be applied to the other substances in the soil to see if the plant absorbed maybe like toxic metals or toxic substances, or it's completely different stuff?
For organic pollutants such as herbicides, pesticides, yes. Maybe a little changes in the methodology, but you can also do something similar.
Other questions, comments? Okay, if so, we shall thank Evelyn. And also we shall thank all the speakers of today. And we will meet tomorrow for more exciting seminars.